Simon & Schuster Audio presents Later by Stephen King. Read by Seth Numrich.
Marsden's house came into view. It was like one of those Hollywood Hills mansions you see in the movies, big and jutting out over the drop. The side facing us was all glass. The house that heroin built. Liz sounded vicious. There was one more curve before we came to the paved yard in front of the house. Liz drove around it, and I saw a man in front of the double garage where Marsden's fancy cars were. I opened my mouth to say it must be Teddy, the gatekeeper, but then I saw his mouth was gone. And given the red hole where his mouth had been, he hadn't died a natural death. Like I said, this is a horror story. Later. I don't like to start with an apology. There's probably even a rule against it, like never ending a sentence with a preposition. But after reading over the 30 pages I've written so far, I feel like I have to. It's about a certain word I keep using. I learned a lot of four-letter words from my mother and used them from an early age, as you will find out, but this is one with five letters. The word is later, as in later on, and later I found out, and it was only later that I realized. I know, it's repetitive, but I had no choice because my story starts when I still believed in Santa Claus and the Tooth Fairy. Although, even at six, I had my doubts. I'm 22 now, which makes this later, right? I suppose when I'm in my 40s, always assuming I make it that far, I'll look back on what I thought I understood at 22 and realize there was a lot I didn't get at all. There's always a later. I know that now, at least until we die. Then I guess it's all before that. My name is Jamie Conklin, and once upon a time, I drew a Thanksgiving turkey that I thought was the absolute cat's ass. Later, and not much later, I found out it was more like the stuff that comes out of the cat's ass. Sometimes the truth really sucks. I think this is a horror story. Check it out. 1. I was coming home from school with my mother. She was holding my hand. In the other hand, I clutched my turkey, the ones we made in first grade the week before Thanksgiving. I was so proud of mine, I was practically shitting nickels. What you did, see, was put your hand on a piece of construction paper and then trace around it with a crayon. That made the tail and body. When it came to the head, you were on your own. I showed mine to Mom, and she's all, yeah, right, totally great, but I don't think she ever really saw it. She was probably thinking about one of the books she was trying to sell. Flogging the product, she called it. Mom was a literary agent, see? It used to be her brother, my Uncle Harry, but Mom took over his business a year before the time I'm telling you about. It's a long story, and kind of a bummer. I said, I used forest green because it's my favorite color. You knew that, right? We were almost to our building by then. It was only 3 blocks from my school. She's all, yeah. Also, you play or watch Barney and the Magic School Bus when we get home, kiddo. I've got like a zillion calls to make. So I go, yeah. Which earned me a poke and a grin. I loved it when I could make my mother grin, because even at six, I knew that she took the world very serious. Later on, I found out part of the reason was me. She thought she might be raising a crazy kid. The day I'm telling you about was the one when she decided for sure I wasn't crazy after all. Which must have been sort of a relief, and sort of not.
You don't talk to anybody about this, she said to me later that day. Except to me, and maybe not even me, kiddo, okay?
I said okay. When you're little and it's your mom, you say okay to everything, unless she says it's bedtime, of course, or to finish your broccoli. We got to our building, and the elevator was still broken. You could say things might have been different if it had been working, but I don't think so. I think that people who say life is all about the choices we make and the roads we go down are full of shit. Because check it, stairs or elevator, we still would have come out on the third floor. When the fickle finger of fate points at you, all roads lead to the same place. That's what I think. I may change my mind when I'm older, but I really don't think so.
Fuck this elevator, Mom said. Then, you didn't hear that, kiddo. Hear what? I said, which got me another grin. Last grin for her that afternoon, I can tell you. I asked her if she wanted me to carry her bag, which had a manuscript in it, like always. That day, a big one, looked like a 500-pager. Mom always sat on a bench reading while she waited for me to get out of school, if the weather was nice. She said, Sweet offer, but what do I always tell you? You have to tote your own burden in life, I said. Correctamundo. Is it Regis Thomas? I asked. Yes, indeed. Good old Regis, who pays our rent. Is it about Roanoke? Do you even have to ask, Jamie? Which made me snicker. Everything good old Regis wrote was about Roanoke. That was the burden he toted in life. We went up the stairs to the third floor, where there were two other apartments plus ours at the end of the hall. Ours was the fanciest one. Mr. and Mrs. Burkett were standing outside 3A, and I knew right away something was wrong because Mr. Burkett was smoking a cigarette, which I hadn't seen him do before and was illegal in our building anyway. His eyes were bloodshot, and his hair was all crazied up in gray spikes. I always called him Mr., but he was actually Professor Burkett and taught something smart at NYU. English and European literature, I later found out. Mrs. Burkett was dressed in a nightgown, and her feet were bare. That nightgown was pretty thin, and I could see most of her stuff right through it. My mother said, Marty, what's wrong? Before he could say anything back, I showed him my turkey, because he looked sad and I wanted to cheer him up, but also because I was so proud of it. Look, Mr. Burkett, I made a turkey. Look, Mrs. Burkett. I held it up for her in front of my face because I didn't want her to think I was looking at her stuff. Mr. Burkett paid no attention. I don't think he even heard me.
Tia, I have some awful news. Mona died this morning.
My mother dropped her bag with the manuscript inside it between her feet and put her hand over her mouth.
Oh no, tell me that's not true.
He began to cry.
She got up in the night and said she wanted a drink of water. I went back to sleep and she was on the couch this morning with a comforter pulled up to her chin. And so I tiptoed to the kitchen and put on the coffee because I thought the pleasant smell would wake.
He really broke down then. Mom took him in her arms the way she did me when I hurt myself, even though Mr. Burkett was about 100. 74, I found out later. That was when Mrs. Burkett spoke to me. She was hard to hear, but not as hard as some of them because she was still pretty fresh. She said, Turkeys aren't green, James.
Well, mine is, I said.
My mother was still holding Mr. Burkett and kind of rocking him. They didn't hear her because they couldn't, and they didn't hear me because they were doing adult things. Comforting for Mom, blubbering for Mr. Burkett. Mr. Burkett said,
I called Dr. Allen, and he came and said she probably had a soak.
At least that's what I thought, he said. He was crying so much it was hard to tell.
He called the funeral parlor. They took her away. I don't know what I'll do without her.
Mrs. Burkett said, My husband is going to burn your mother's hair with his cigarette if he doesn't look out. And sure enough, he did. I could smell the singeing hair, a kind of beauty shop smell. Mom was too polite to say anything about it, but she made him let go of her, and then she took the cigarette from him and dropped it on the floor and stepped on it. I thought that was a grody thing to do, extreme litter bugging, but I didn't say anything. I got that it was a special situation. I also knew that talking to Mrs. Burkett anymore would freak him out. Mom, too. Even a little kid knows certain basic things if he's not soft in the attic. You said please, you said thank you, you didn't flap your weenie around in public or chew with your mouth open, and you didn't talk to dead folks when they were standing next to living folks who were just starting to miss them. I only want to say in my own defense that when I saw her, I didn't know she was dead. Later on, I got better at telling the difference, but back then, I was just learning. It was her nightgown I could see through, not her. Dead people look just like living people, except they're always wearing the clothes they died in. Meanwhile, Mr. Burkett was rehashing the whole thing. He told my mother how he sat on the floor beside the couch and held his wife's hand till that doctor guy came, and again till the mortician guy came to take her away.
Conveyed her hence,
was what he actually said,
which I didn't understand until Mom explained it to me. And at first I thought he said beautician, maybe because of the smell when he burned Mom's hair. His crying had tapered off, but now it ramped up again.
Her rings are gone, he said through his tears. Both her wedding ring and her engagement ring, that big diamond. I looked on the night table by her side of the bed where she puts them when she rubs that awful-smelling arthritis cream into her hands. It does smell bad, Mrs. Burkett admitted. Lanolin is basically sheep dip, but it really helps. I nodded to show I understood, but didn't say anything.
And on the bathroom sink, because sometimes she leaves them there. I've looked everywhere.
They'll turn up, my mother soothed.
And now that her hair was safe, she took Mr. Burkett in her arms again.
They'll turn up, Marty. Don't you worry about that.
I miss her so much. I miss her already.
Mrs. Burkett flapped a hand in front of her face. I give him 6 weeks before he's asking Dolores McGowan out to lunch. Mr. Burkett was blubbing, and my mother was doing her soothing thing.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.